Wofford Terriers invade Blue Hen Country. Powered by a throwback offense, Wofford is the little school that could. But the road to the title game goes through the first state. Delaware is a traditional 1AA power. The Blue Hens are looking for their first trip to the championship game in 21 years. The Blue Hens and the Terriers. Only one is heading to Chattanooga.
ESPN2 welcomes you to Tubby Raymond Field at Delaware Stadium. It's the first ever meeting between Wofford and Delaware. The stakes couldn't be much higher. The winner will play for a national championship on Friday night. Hi, everybody, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough along with Rod Gilmore and Mike Gottfried. Delighted to have you with us. Gentlemen, the stakes couldn't be much higher, and these schools and programs couldn't be much more different. Wofford, the smallest school in Division 1A football or 1AA football, just 1,100 students, just their ninth year as a 1AA program, first ever appearance in the playoffs. Delaware, a perennial power, 12th appearance in the playoffs, 16,000 students. That's more students than Wofford has, living alumni. And, Mike, certainly a contrast in football styles, too.
Yeah, Sean, and contrast in offenses, mainly because whoever dictates the pace early in this football game offensively will win this game. Wofford doesn't throw the football. Six passes in their two playoff wins. But the best player on the field might be Matt Nelson, the safety for Wofford.
Yeah, he's pretty good. I like that option that they run there at Wofford. But a different style at Delaware. They run the spread attack. You've seen it with Northwestern and Clemson, teams like that. But for them, it all begins at the quarterback with Andy Hall. He's a great player out of Georgia Tech, transferred here, but he's been banged up, Sean, with a bad shoulder. Question is, will he be able to make it through the ball game and be effective throwing and running?
He was the Atlantic 10 Conference Offensive Player of the Year. Delaware won the toss and deferred. So Wofford, dressed in the white uniforms, will receive the opening kickoff. Brad Shushman to kick off. And we're underway on a clear but brisk and cool afternoon in Newark, Delaware. Shield Wood took a knee as the kickoff went a couple of yards deep into the end zone. Wofford will alternate quarterbacks. Jeff Zolman, the junior from Dayton, is the starter. He'll likely play two or three series, and then Trey Rogers will come into the ball game. And Zolman has been terrific in their two playoff victories. Last week he rushed for three touchdowns and 94 yards against Western Kentucky, and in their opening round win against North Carolina A&T, he rushed for 141 yards and two touchdowns. A surprise as they come out throwing, and the pass is on target to the 26-yard line to Shield Wood, his 21st reception of the season. He's their leading receiver. The Wofford offense, the fullback, the primary focus in this wing bone, J.R. McNair, the student body president, fills that position. And up front, an excellent offensive line led by Eric Deutsch. He won the Jacobs Blocking Trophy as the best offensive lineman in the Southern Conference. Walker, the champions of the Southern Conference. Zolman keeps and goes to the 28, tackled by safety Kyle Campbell. Up front, the Atlantic 10 Conference Defensive Player of the Year, Sean Johnson, with Jennings, Parks, and Santoli. Outstanding group of linebackers, Mulhern, Davis, and Moore. Moore is a former walk-on. And in the secondary, the leader of the group is Mike Adams, Kyle Campbell, another former walk-on, and Sidney Hoggebrook is an all-conference performer.
I can't believe they threw a pass already.
That's their seventh pass now in the playoffs. This is their third playoff game. On third and two, Zolman gets belted down for a loss by Sean Johnson, the conference player of the year. First year here at Delaware as a transfer from Duke. And when you watch them on tape, guys, he is a star.
Well, he's a dominant player. You saw that replay where he just destroyed the blocker, read the option there, and went right to the quarterback. He's not only strong, he's quick. He's going to present a problem for Wofford all day. They got to make him declare what he's going to do right away, Coach.
Yeah, Rod, I would think that go to the left side a little bit more, go away from him.
Jimmy Miner, four times an All-Southern Conference punter each of his 4 years, and that was a boomer all the way to the 25. Being run back by Hoggebrook. And the punter, Jimmy Miner, had to make the tackle. A 45-yard punt, but a 37-yard return. And here comes Andy Hall. As Rod mentioned, the senior from Shirah, South Carolina, is playing with a third-degree separation of his left shoulder. All the ligaments in his shoulder that attach the collarbone to the shoulder blade are damaged, and he'll need surgery at the end of the year. He did not practice at all this week. First and 10 from the Wofford 38. And the handoff to Jermaine Bennett. And he's stopped for a loss. Let's check in down to the field. Here's Holly Rowe.
Well, Sean, as you mentioned, Andy Hall is playing with a grade 3 separation of the shoulder. That means all three ligaments are severely torn. Now, he has been shot up with some lidocaine before the game. It's his non-throwing shoulder, and they said that they're going to have to see how he can stand it during the game. It's not so much the pain that bothers him. It's the muscle spasms through his neck and through his trapezius muscle. So we'll keep our eye on how physical he can be. He likes to run the ball, but he may be limited today. Guys?
He's dealing with four wide receivers now as they go out of the spread. He's also a very effective runner. He's run for more than 600 yards. He's on target to David Bowler, his 52nd reception. He's their leading receiver. Alex Love made the tackle, but it's a first down for Delaware at the 27-yard line. The rest of the offense, they open with three wide receivers, Blaymeyer and Long, and Lavelle is the tight end. And up front, the best of the bunch is Jason Neeris, the right guard, a first-team All-Atlantic 10 performer. One back in, two tight ends, and a quick drop by Hall. Out into the flat it goes, caught by Justin Long. He sneaks down the sideline and is out of bounds at the 8-yard line. Tackled by Matt Nelson.
Oh, Coach, we've already seen multiple formations, a two-back set, a one-back set with four wide receivers, and then this one with just two. A little bit of confusion for Wofford having to adjust to so much stuff going on right now when they expected always to see a one-back with two wide receivers. This team is spreading them out, showing some different things already.
Long, their second leading receiver. They have three standout sophomore wide receivers in Bowler, Long, and Ingram. Movement along the line. It's a Gateway Conference officiating crew, led by the referee John Sullivan.
First snap, full start on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
And for Wofford on defense, a front three of Whitney, Bethay, and Basinger. They're banged up at linebacker. Josh Smith steps in today for Jim Thurman, who did not make the trip with an ankle injury. And Nelson, they think, is the best defensive back ever to play at Wofford. He's a candidate for the Buck Buchanan Award as the best defensive player in 1AA football. Two tight ends and one back. And the deep handoff to Bennett, and he gets nothing. Swung down by Lee Basinger, the right tackle, junior from Kannapolis, North Carolina.
Hey, Sean and Rod, I think the best thing when you look at this matchup, Delaware's won 15 or last 16 at home. It's a big advantage to be right here. Don't travel, play at home. Andy Hall's 14-0 as a starting quarterback at home.
And both of their wins in the playoffs so far have been here at home. Victories over Southern Illinois and Northern Iowa. This is the first road game in the playoff for Wofford. Their wins over North Carolina A&T and Western Kentucky were at home in Spartanburg, South Carolina. Bennett, the ball carrier, he's near the 11-yard line. Tackled by Caton Bethay with help from Josh Smith.
Now, Coach, just to follow up on your point about playing at home, Delaware has gotten off to fast starts in their first two ball games. That's allowed them to be dominant and to rest Hall in the second half of ball games because they've been so dominant, and that home field advantage is a factor in that.
A.C. Keeler, former three-year starter linebacker at Delaware, now in his second year as head coach. He followed the legendary Tubby Raymond, who was here for 36 years. Third and goal. The pass is caught short of the end zone by Brian Ingram. They'll give him forward progress to the 4-yard line, and the field goal unit comes on for Delaware.
Yeah, it's good that they can hold them to field goal here, because when you're an option team and you can't throw the ball, we shouldn't say they can't throw the ball. They don't prefer to throw the football. But when you get behind, then you got to get away from what you do best. Now, not one score or two scores, but pace early is big.
Well, they've only thrown the ball 100 times this season or so. So you're right. They don't want to get behind and have to throw it 25 times in a ball game.
Brad Schuschman with Joe Blaymeyer, the holder. And it's up and good from 22 yards. His school record 17th field goal of the season. And he adds to his single season school record point total as well. Now with 108. 3-0 Delaware. Early in the first quarter here in Newark. The Wofford Terriers, the Terrier nickname shared by just two other universities around the country, St. Francis of New York and Boston University. Delaware leads 3-0 on a 22-yard field goal by Brad Schuschman. It was a short field after the excellent punt return by Sidney Hagebrook. 7 plays, 35 yards to set up the field goal. And now Schuschman, a transfer from Louisville, kicks off. Devious Johnson and Shield Wood are back deep, and it comes down to Johnson at the goal line. And he is upended short of the 20. This is a fired up Delaware team. Here's Holly Rowe.
We already saw a great strategic move in this game when Casey Keeler deferred and let his defense take the field first for Delaware. They told us yesterday, because of the preparation for this wing bone style of offense is difficult to run at speed, they thought it would take a couple of series for their defense to get up to par. When their defense came out and shut them down, shut Wofford down on the very first series and forced a punt, the defense came over with so much confidence. We'll see if they can build and grow that confidence from this point.
All right, Holly. From the 18-yard line, first and 10 for the Terriers. The option, and Zolman carries out to the 23. We welcome those of you who are joining us. We're at Tubby Raymond Field, affectionately known as the Tub here at Delaware Stadium. Division I AA semifinal action between the 3-seed Wofford and the number 2-seed Delaware. Delaware leads 3-0. They took advantage of a good punt return by Sidney Hagebrook that set up a field goal of 22 yards by Brad Schuschman. Wofford with its second possession of the football game. And nothing doing on that play. Zolman dropped for a loss by Mike Adams, the senior safety, who missed some time during the middle of the season after he broke his right fibula in mid-October in a game against Rhode Island.
Guys, when you're an option team and you throw the ball, you want to hit big plays. You want the element of surprise. You don't want your quarterback in a position where he's being pressured like that. That was not a good set for Wofford.
Third down and 5. And J.R. McNair out to the 26. Now, this would seem to be an obvious punting situation, but Wofford goes for it on fourth down about as often as any team that you'll ever encounter. They've gone for it 47 times this year, made 29 of them for 62% for coach Mike Ayers, and it looks like they're going to go for this one at their own 26, fourth down and 2.
Are you kidding me?
This is a big risk by Wofford.
And this is the way they've played all season to get here, and Mike Ayers is going to stay with what got him to this point.
Trying to draw him offside.
And then a timeout called by Zolman.
Worth a try.
Timeout. Wofford, your first timeout of the
midway
half.
Through the first quarter, it's Delaware with a 3-0 lead. A crisp December day here in Newark, Delaware. Delaware trying to get to the national championship game for the first time since 1982. They won the national championship in 1979. Jimmy Miner to punt for the second time. This one short and wobbly, but it takes a good bounce for Wofford. Sidney Hagebrook backed away. No chance to return that one. And it rolls to the 29, a 45-yard punt for the great miner who they think has a career in the NFL ahead of him.
Pretty good kick there. But, Sean, I want to go back to what Holly said, that Delaware's defense has to take a couple series to get used to Wofford's offense, and that's true. But also Wofford, because you don't play teams from the east when you're in the south, so you have to take a little bit more time to figure out the speed of the defensive linemen also.
Well, keep in mind that Wofford hasn't used his bread and butter offense yet either. It's been a lot of wing tee, not much option for them.
Andy Hall hands it off to Antoine Jenkins. He and Bennett are a 1-2 punch at running back for Delaware. They're roommates, close friends since they came on a recruiting trip together here 5 years ago. Jenkins more of the physical runner at 240. He's Cadillac, the other guy's Porsche.
Yeah, well, I thought there was another Cadillac in Auburn, Cadillac Williams.
Yeah, so you can only have one Cadillac.
There's a bunch of Cadillacs out there this year.
He's just short
not
of the first
Porsches,
down.
Not many Porsches, though, Sean.
Yes. Second down and one. And it's Jenkins again for the first down, out to the 41-yard line.
Well, you like the 1-2 punch of the running back for Delaware. Last week, it was in spectacular form. Jenkins, the second runner there. The first one was Jermaine Bennett. And it is a little bit of lightning and thunder when you think about it. This guy is the speedster of a Jermaine. They combined for 217 yards last week. And it's his first year as a starter. He was a backup for three seasons.
Backup last year to Keith Burnell, who transferred in from Virginia Tech for 1 year. Bennett's been patiently waiting for his chance. Jenkins carries out to the 44. That's a gain of three. Tackle made by Shane Fast, a backup safety, senior from Union, South Carolina.
Delaware, no huddle offense. Never huddles up. Does different paces during the ball game. Right now, they're in a slow pace. Just hoping the coaches get from the sideline what they expect of the adjustments of Wofford's defense.
Out of the shotgun now, Andy Hall in his second year here after he transferred in from Georgia Tech. He's been the starter both years here at Delaware. Dumps it off short. Jenkins bounced off the hit and got very close to a first down. He may have it at the Wofford 49. Jimmy Freeland made the tackle.
Yeah, we talk about Delaware earlier and their history, their storied program. A lot of that has to do with the fact that they take transfers. I mean, you look at this program, they've got a quarterback from Georgia Tech, a wide receiver from USC, a defensive end from Duke. They get guys that come in for a year or two at key positions that really kind of elevate their team to a different level than most 1AA teams.
And they can play right away. So they can come in the spring and watch the practice and decide if they want to come in here.
If you drop down a level in college football, you don't need to sit out a year as a transfer. But they also get a lot of recruits who come here right out of high school. This program has a great history and tradition. They play in front of very large crowds. Antoine Jenkins, the ball carrier, is near another first down at the 39. 17th playoff appearance, the 12th in Division I AA. They were the Division II national champions under Tubby Raymond on a team on which Casey Keeler, their current head coach, played. Haven't been to the 1AA championship game since 82.
Yeah, Tubby Raymond with 300 wins and did a great job here. Three coaches, Hall of Fame coaches, Davey Nelson, Bill Murray, and Tubby Raymond. So you have a lot of pressure on you if you're going to coach here at Delaware, because they haven't had many coaches. They've all been successful.
Well, how many coaches have a field named after them? They call this place the Tub.
Couple coaches. Cemetery plots named after coaches, but
and of course it's a big change in style. All those years, the wing tee under Tubby Raymond. Casey Keeler played on the wing tee team as a defensive player, linebacker. They were 4-6 the last year under Coach Raymond. Casey Keeler came in last year with a spread that was very successful for him in his time as head coach at Rowan College in New Jersey, where he built a Division III powerhouse. They were 6-6 last year with some very narrow defeats. And this year they won just about all the close ones and come in with a 13-1 record, tied for the most wins in school history in a single season. On second and short, It's Jenkins up the middle for a first down.
Sean, what you're talking about, when you have all the success that Delaware's had, to go outside the family, Blue Hen family, would have been a mistake. So Keeler was the right choice. 250 applicants for the job.
And
so everybody
job.
Wanted to come here because you can win here.
Well, he had to sell them, too, on the offense he was going to put in. As you mentioned, the wing T was here, and he brought the spread offense, and folks weren't used to that here.
J.C. Keeler trying to win his first championship as a coach, five times for the Division III title game without winning. There's now room in the great power in Division III football, standing in the way most of those years. Joe Blaymeyer the catch, and another first down for Delaware inside the 23-yard line, a gain of 13.
Now, Wofford doesn't have answers right now for Delaware's offense. Wofford's only given up 17 points in the last 12 games. Nobody scored over 17 points on this defense, but right now they're off balance.
Well, that's because Delaware is balanced. When they go to the two tight end offense, that balances up that defensive front, and they're a little bigger and stronger. They can pound it and then play action throw it.
They have three tight ends on the field. They've moved Blyler, one of those, into the backfield as the fullback, leading the way for Jenkins for a short gain. Here's Matt Weiner in the studio.
Sean, as we continue to keep you updated on all the playoff games around the country today, the other 1AA semifinal, Colgate and Florida Atlantic. It's Lane Schwartzberg with the 30-yarder. That makes it 9-0 the gate.
Schwartzberg goes 10 of 30.
They're not going to know what to do down there in South Florida after playing their first two games at Colgate at home in blizzard conditions. In Hamilton, New York, in their games against UMass and Western Illinois. Second down in 10 for Delaware with a 3-0 lead. And a timeout called by Andy Hall. 3:41 left in the first quarter. Delaware. The winner advances to the national championship game. We'll return to Newark right after this. Sean McDonough, Mike Gottfried, Rod Gilmore, and Holly Rowe back in Newark, Delaware. The Fighting Blue Hens have a 3-0 lead. Six first downs to nothing in favor of Delaware. And they're looking at 6-10 after a Blue Hens timeout. At the 22-yard line of Wofford. Out of the gun, Andy Hall. It's a deflected pass, and if he caught it in the air, it's intercepted. And it is an interception for Wofford.
Josh Smith.
The junior from Greer, South Carolina, who's filling in as a starter today because Jimmy Thurman's not here with an ankle injury, and a big play by Smith.
Well, you called it right at the start. It was a tip ball. I couldn't see who got it. But, you know, you need throwing lanes, Coach. When you try to throw quickly over the middle, you got to cut linemen to get throwing lanes.
Caden Bethay deflected it. So here comes Wofford. On first and 10, the carry out to the 21-yard line by J.R. McNair. 11th interception by a linebacker. They actually have more interceptions among their linebacking corps now than they do from the defensive backs.
They forced four turnovers last week against Western Kentucky. So that was a big one for them.
They're now plus 23 for the year. If you're looking at the formula for success for Wofford, Mark Moore tackled J.R. McNair. It is amazing job protecting the ball and not turning it over. Plus 22 is staggering, and very few penalties. They average just 35 penalty yards per game.
Sean, one thing I would do if I was Wofford, the offensive coordinator Wade Lang, is run to the left side a little bit more, because I think they get more over there. Sean Johnson on Delaware's left side has been too tough for him to block.
Wofford looking for its first down. And that'll be close as Zolman extended the ball. John Mulhern chopped him down, and it will be a first down as the officials move the chain gang. First down ball game for the Terriers.
Midline option where it's going to go right up the middle, and the quarterback's going to follow the fullback, McNair. Now, once you close on the fullback, then the quarterback is able to pick up that first down.
Coleman pitches it back to Kevious Johnson. And he's out of bounds, but they run the clock, ruling him down before he crossed the boundary at the 32-yard line. Good run by the Southern Conference Freshman of the Year. He's from Fitzgerald, Georgia. Not very big at 5'9 and 180, but he's impressive.
Coach, you go back to the first couple of series for Wofford. We did not see the midline option. We didn't see the base option. We saw wing T, but they're getting a little bit more to their base offense, although they're in a wing T formation right now.
Now to the 35-yard line goes Aaron Johnson, a sophomore from Bowling Green, Kentucky. Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Well, Coach Godfrey was saying that Wofford would take their time trying to figure out how to play against Delaware, and that's true. During the last offensive timeout, while they were on the sideline, Coach Harris came over and questioned the offensive line to see if they needed to adjust their split. They're making some subtle adjustments on the line. So far, it's working on this series.
Not on that play. Gabriel Jackson dropped for a loss. By Lou Samba, the defensive end, sophomore from Norristown, Pennsylvania.
Just a good job on defense by Delaware. Delaware's front defensive linemen, Rodney, are kind of controlling the offensive line of Wofford.
I like the fact that they're moving Sean Johnson around. They moved him to the right end that time, make him effective, make a guessing game for Wofford.
Third punt of the quarter for Jimmy Meyer, and another boomer by Miner. Hagerbrook caught it while retreating. Dan goes out of bounds at the 21-yard line. Alex Love forced him out, a 47-yard punt by Miner. Tonight at 8 o'clock, the Heisman Trophy presentation presented by Wendy's. The show starts with Reese Davis, Trev Alberts, Mark May live from Grand Central Station. Reese then joins Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, and Kirk Herbstreit of the Yale Club for live interviews with the finalists, family members, and coaches. The finalists, Jason White, Eli Manning, Larry Fitzgerald, and Chris Perry. Guys, who's going to win?
I think Ben Roethlisberger ought to be there, the Miami of Ohio quarterback.
Oh, he's not going to win,
though. No, I'm just saying, he should be there. He's the best quarterback in the country.
Hall steps back to throw, under pressure from behind and tripped up. It is a gain on the play. He was tackled by Jimmy Freeland, the junior from Cincinnati. All right, Ben Roethlisberger, Mike, is not going to win. Hey, so the question again is, who is?
You asked me who's going to win it. I'm saying Ben Roethlisberger is the best quarterback in the country. He's not going to win the Heisman.
He's not the best. I don't think he's the best quarterback. I think Eli Manning is a better quarterback. I think Jason White will win, but I would vote for Eli Manning because I think he played better in pressure games. I agree with the coach on that one.
And that's the end of the first quarter here. I think Jason White will win. I think Larry Fitzgerald should win.
Okay.
He was the best player I saw in college football this year. A quarter controlled by Delaware, but after one, they're ahead by just 3-0. The only scoring in the first quarter, a 22-yard field goal by Brad Shushman of Delaware, and the Fighting Blue Hens lead 3-0. Second and 6 for Delaware from its own 25 on the first play of the second quarter. And the tight end, Glyler, moved into the backfield, leading the way for Jermaine Bennett. He's out to the 28. Bennett very nearly was not on this football team. Deep into the Casey Keeler regime. Tubby Raymond told Casey Keeler he was very close to throwing Bennett out of the program, a problem with tardiness and a few other issues. And Casey Keeler said, he didn't get off to a good start with me either. He was late for the first two workouts, and I went to Jermaine and said, don't make my first act as head coach be throwing you off the team. He shaped up and has become a great performer. Kirk Chiracca, the offensive coordinator, says he doesn't know if there's a better backfield tandem in the country than his duo of Bennett and Jenkins. All throws, first down. Out to the 33-yard line. Caught by Brian Ingram, the sophomore from Stone Mountain, Georgia, at 6'5", the tallest receiver in school history.
Yeah, going back to the story on Jermaine Bennett, he epitomizes part of the concern or problems you have when you bring in transfers, because Keith Burnell came in from Virginia Tech as a running back, and so that made it hard for Jermaine Bennett to be the guy, and he had been waiting his turn, so he went into a funk instead of responding to the competition like they wanted. So you have to be careful when you bring transfers. The chemistry, it can affect the team.
Here's Bennett weaving through traffic and breaking tackles, and he's out to the 41. Very nice 7-yard run by the senior from Clinton, Maryland. Tackled by John Presley as we look at the ESPN game track.
Well, it's been all about defense for Delaware, stopping the wing bone, the option all over the quarterback. Sean Johnson making great plays in the passing game. Paul 6-for-7 at the quarterback spot for Delaware.
Wofford has just 27 yards of offense. Paul throws through the hands of Justin Long along the near sideline. Alex Love had the coverage. Wofford playing without Dedrick Stuckey, one of their starting cornerbacks. He suffered an ankle injury last week against Western Kentucky, did not make the trip. And another one of their corners, Craig Thomas, is playing with a sore ankle that he rolled a couple of days ago in practice. They weren't sure he'd play today for Wofford until just before game time.
Coach, your guy Matt Nelson's gonna have to make some plays. They get that safety involved for Wofford.
Third down and a short three. They need to make the 44-yard line. And they hand it off inside to Jermaine Bennett. He has the first down up to the 46.
Sean, I want to go back to Bennett because your story and Rodney's story. The key thing I thought when we talked to Keeler, Coach Keeler from Delaware, he said, I called his mom. And then after I called his mom, said he's about ready to go out of here, he started doing the right thing. And so that mom is powerful when you get to her. And that was a big call for this young man's future.
He's rushed for 15 yards today. He needs 75 more to set their single season rushing record. Started the day with 1,379 yards. This year, Bennett again out near the 50. They'll mark it back near the 49-yard line. Bill Pryor made the tackle with help from Timmy Thrift. And they go quickly this time. Bennett short of the first down. He's to the Wofford 47-yard line. They'll need three more to move the chains on third down.
Rodney, you're right. Sean was talking about a quicker pace. Now all of a sudden, if you're the defensive coordinator for Wofford, you got to get the call in earlier. And your defense doesn't get a chance to huddle.
Yeah.
To build on the strength of your teammates.
Yep. That's exactly right. They got comfortable out there, and that change of pace makes them hurry up a little bit.
Not as big a problem for Wofford as it would be for other teams because they usually do not huddle while on defense. They went to that when they played Clemson and have stayed with that no huddle on defense look. The catch and first down for Brian Ingram at the 43-yard line. He made it by a yard. Delaware continues on the move, leading 3-0.
And patience. You see Delaware's offense being very patient because Wofford is playing a very soft zone. They take away the deep ball. And Delaware is content, Andy Hall in particular, is content to pick underneath and take the 5 yards that they're willing to give him.
Domination by Delaware. Wofford has to feel fortunate to be trailing just 3-0. Here is the 10th play of the drive. And it's Bennett again for nothing. Jimmy Freeland, the linebacker, with help from Ben Whitney, made the stop. Freeland's out of Princeton High School in Cincinnati, where he was the homecoming king his senior year.
Well, he made a great play on that play defensively. Number 54, Jimmy Freeland, moved right down the line of scrimmage and made that tackle.
Second and 10. Andy Hall in the shotgun. Movement along the line. There is a flag down. Be a rare infraction against Wofford. Andy Hall carried to the 39, but they'll likely take the penalty. Teddy Whitaker made the tackle. Wofford in two games in the playoffs had committed a total of 4 penalties.
Yeah, with Wofford, you don't need referees and you don't need air in the football because they don't throw the football and they don't have penalties.
Well, it's amazing. In the playoffs, Wofford has run the ball more than 95% of their offensive plays.
Offsides, defense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
First penalty against Wofford. And that gives Delaware second down and five. Gives us time to tell you about Grand Valley State, the defending champion, taking on the Fighting Sioux of North Dakota in the Division II championship game today at 4 from Florence, Alabama. Hall out of the gun. And has a man wide open. It's Joe Blaymeyer. And he battles down to the 30. Joe is the son of Gene Blaymeyer, who is the athletic director at Boise State. What a terrific program they have.
Well, Blaymeyer began his career at Arizona State, where he walked on and then left that program to come out to Delaware to get a chance to play a little bit more. And you see him here. They just flood that area, coach, with three receivers with two defenders up close. You got more receivers than defenders. You pick up a few yards.
Blaymeyer sent tapes to the Delaware coaches. Kirk Shiraka, the offensive coordinator, called him and said, we can't promise you a scholarship, but we think you can play. And if you come here and prove it, we'll give you a scholarship. By the third day of his first practice sessions, he had a scholarship.
That's pretty good. 3 days?
Yeah, took him three practices. They said, okay, you've proven it. We'll give you the scholarship. And Joe has been a factor, 17 receptions prior to today. Bennett carried for a short gain. Everything in the passing game short. You think they're setting up Wofford eventually for a deeper ball?
The short pass is there. The last drive, they just ran out of room, and Wofford forced them to a field goal.
Yeah, Wofford's not going to give them anything deep. They will play three or four across deep and really give you a lot of room.
We're going to get man coverage here.
And the pass caught by a sliding Justin Long. And that'll bring up third down. They've been very good on third downs on this drive. They'll need four here. And even though it's a no huddle, they pride themselves on winning the time of possession battle. This is a sustained drive.
Really, Delaware has controlled this first half to this point in a fast-moving game.
But they're being patient, hurrying, but not getting out of sync. They're really doing a nice job with the clock.
Moving on the line again. No flags down, though, and it's Hall carrying for the first down.
I'm a little surprised.
I am, too. I know what you're going to say. 8 to 10 times a game, Andy Hall runs the football. He ran it 3 times last week. When you're injured, he's got that left shoulder injury, but it was there.
Yeah, and he used that left shoulder. And remember, he had a shot. It's numb, and he used that numb left shoulder to take on the blocker there, and that ball could easily have come out. I wonder just how much he can feel with that left arm, that left shoulder.
As Holly said earlier, he gets the shot before every game, has it padded with extra padding. Says usually he doesn't feel much during the game. On first and 10, the 15th play of the drive, it's Jermaine Bennett down near the 17-yard line.
You know, guys,
here's where in the last series that Delaware bogged down a little bit because they ran out of room throwing the football, and they're having a harder time running the football against Wofford.
Well, they're not going to get man coverage down in the red zone here. I think they're going to get a zone around the goal line, and they're going to have to find their way in those little areas.
Again, move it, but no flags. Dan Bennett slides down to the 13-yard line. They wonder why there hasn't been a flag now twice when there's been movement along the line at the snap. Apparently, they've been getting back.
Now, what do you think, Coach?
Offside.
Look pretty close there. I'll go with you on that one.
Third down and 4. And that ball incomplete. Intended for David Bowler. Again, the fans wanted a flag. It was Alex Love who had the coverage.
And Bowler is a big receiver. He's about 6'2", 200. And he gets a little love there. Alex goes at about 180 pounds, taking on the bigger receiver. I thought the timing was pretty good. What do you think, Coach?
I agree. I know you're a defensive back, but I agree. They shouldn't be booing there. Forced them again. Wofford's defense won again if they forced the field goal.
Delaware had converted on three third downs of the drive, stopped on the fourth try. So here's Shushman from 30 yards. Line drive kick, and it's no good. He missed it. Wide left. Well, Mike Ayers has to be delighted. His team has been dominated here in the first half, but trails by only 3-0. All right, thank you, Matt. And here in Delaware, it's the Fighting Blue Hens leading 3-0. But they came up empty after an 18-play, nearly 9-minute long drive. And Trey Rogers is in at quarterback. As we mentioned, this is by design. It's not an indication that Zolman was ineffective. He generally comes in on the third or fourth series. And Corey Dunn is the ball carrier, tackled by Dave Camburn. So far, no problems defensively for Delaware against this wing bone, which will now be directed by the junior from Spartanburg, which is the home of Wofford College. Rogers out of Dorman High School. And he hands it off to J.R. McNair, the student body president. And he's just short of their second first down of the afternoon. Sean Johnson and John Mulhern the tackle.
Well, it's been all about the Delaware defense. They've shut down this pretty good offensive running game by Wofford. They've taken away the wing T, the option, and then a little bit of the power game. They've shut that down too, and it's been a lot of Sean Johnson, 96, their defensive end, who's wreaked a lot of havoc up front.
Third down and inches. And Rogers keeps for the first down. Let's check in again with Matt.
All right, Sean, when we last checked in, the Owls were knocking on the door down in Fort Lauderdale, and they have punched it in. Doug Parker will do the honors for Florida Atlantic. And Howard Schnellenberger's team back within two. It's 9-7.
And what a season Colgate has had. A non-scholarship program. We talked about Wofford not being at the full allotment of scholarships. You're allowed 63 football scholarships in 1AA. They have 48. Colgate doesn't have any. All of their financial aid to the football players is loans. Rogers on first down, tripped up behind the line of scrimmage by Tom Parks. Terrific play by the sophomore from Pittsburgh out of North Allegheny High School.
Well, Coach, we knew he was physical, but I don't think we knew he was that quick. Watch how quickly he beats that block of the guard. He just gets right in there. He was going right now and got into the backfield.
That's his 12th tackle for a loss, so he's been in many backfields this season.
He's from a football family. His dad played at Kent State and Indiana, Pennsylvania. His brother Luke played at Dayton. His dad's now a special agent of the FBI. His mom is a speech therapist. Here's the pitch to Kevius Johnson. He took a pretty good lick, but keeps going forward. Mike Adams came up to bang him near the 32-yard line. They'll give him forward progress out to the 34. And it'll be third down and 7 for the Terriers of Wofford.
Well, Sean Johnson's had a great first half so far, but this time they run this ball at him. He takes an inside move against this wide split that they have.
Third down and 7. Rogers looks to throw and completes it for a first down. Out to the 45-yard line.
One thing about quarterbacks, when you play two quarterbacks, I'm not a two quarterback guy, but sometimes when you're struggling on offense and the other quarterback comes in the ball game, he can spark a rally. And Trey Rogers is sparking this offense.
What'd you tell me? If you have two quarterbacks, you have no quarterback?
Well, you don't have one.
Brian Rice made the catch, now back to the ground. J.R. McNair got nothing. That's the second pass on the previous play of the game for Wofford. They completed both of them. I don't know how McNair does everything that he does. He's the student body president. He's involved in just about every possible activity in which you can be involved in their campus. Member of the gospel choir.
When he carries the ball at home, they play Hail to the Chief. I mean, I've never heard of a player getting Hail to the Chief every time he carries the football.
He's a 3-6-4 student, as a philosophy major. They flip it on a reverse to Brandon Berry, a true freshman. And well defended by Delaware. Berry out of bounds near the 50-yard line. They'll rule him down inbounds to keep the clock moving at the 50. It'll bring up third down and 5. Mark Moore made the tackle.
Yeah, but this play is made by Ben Cross, 26. He stays home. Well, look how far deep he forces that play to go. And he forces it way back, and that allows his teammates to come over and make the play.
We talk about great students. Cross, an academic All-American, 3.93 in civil engineering. He was also the best conditioned athlete on their team in their test that measured conditioning, strength, speed, and agility. Not a bad combination when you're the best student in the best condition. McNair up the middle. He's short of the first down by a yard. I'll bet the house they go for it on this fourth down. Monroe Davis made the tackle. I'll bet the house.
What kind of house you live in?
Not bad. Not as nice as your elegant spread down there in Alabama, but it's not bad.
Well, you're going to win.
Yeah, well, I would still kick this thing. I mean, you know, you got a chance to back them up for the first time. If you miss this one, you're giving them great field position, coach. It's risky.
Yeah, this is what they've done all year, though. You know, and I admire that. A lot of times, coach, in big games, you see teams go away from them. They've done all year to get there. Mike Ayers is going to continue to play the same way. They've won 12 straight games, and they trail 3-0. Fourth down and 1 for Wofford. The Terriers trailing 3-0 and going for it. Just outside the 46-yard line of Delaware with under a minute and a half left in a very fast-moving first half. The pitch to Johnson, and he has the first down. Dave Camburn made the tackle. That tackle might have saved a touchdown. He was the last line of defense for Delaware. First and 10, Wofford at the 40.
Sean, with the time on the clock and averaging 267 yards rushing, and like you said, that's what got him here. You dance with who brought you.
Okay, but now you got a minute and 15. You don't really throw the ball that well. How you gonna get that
throw the
points?
Ball. They gotta throw.
Only one timeout left for Wofford as well. They do throw. Rogers under siege, just throws it up and away in the general direction of Aaron Johnson, but Rogers just trying to get rid of the ball.
So when you don't have a two-minute offense, you don't do this all season long, and you go for it on fourth down, now you've got to find a way to do something you haven't done all year, Sean. You
but
have not done this.
Say, Wade Lang, we talked to him yesterday, the offense coordinator, said, we practice passing in practice probably more than any team in the country.
They threw 100 passes this season.
And he said we can throw if we need to. We
they
just haven't
threw
had
six
to.
Passes in the first two playoff games. They're going to throw, what, a dozen in the first half? That's out of character.
Might be out of character, but he maintains we have the line, the quarterbacks, and the receivers to throw the ball if need be. They stay on the ground. Kevious Johnson down to the 35. They either need to use that timeout or get up quickly. Monroe Davis made the tackle. Davis.
They need about 10, 15 yards right here to tie this football game up. They got a lot of time. They still have one timeout left.
40 seconds left. Rogers, a quick throw, deflected and still caught. And if they give him forward progress, it's a first down. Dominic Santoli deflected it.
Oh, he got a good spot on that one.
When you don't throw, you need every break you can get.
They did get it as Brandon Berry made the catch. Just his second catch of the year for the true freshman from Knoxville.
The ball gets tipped and the guy gets hit and they get the tip in their direction and they get the spot.
32 seconds left as they lined up. The pitch to Corey Dunn. He did not get out of bounds. That was a big mistake. He was right along the boundary. And the clock is running. And now Wofford has to use that timeout with 16 seconds left.
Timeout.
Wofford out of timeouts. In field goal range, though, with a chance at least to tie. Second down for Wofford and 3 yards to go. Rogers throws to the sideline, dropped It was a well-designed play, and Aaron Johnson, if he caught it, was going to run right out of bounds near the 10 to stop the clock. Officially 11 seconds left in the half. And a third down and three upcoming, and Casey Keeler didn't like something that he saw.
Well, he's complaining that his guys, in particular Sean Johnson, is not getting the holding call. That Johnson getting into the backfield was tackled. He wants that call.
Nash is the best receiver, number six, on the short side of the field.
At the top of your screen, Corey Dunn came in motion, stays in the block for Rodgers. Rodgers scrambles very near the line of scrimmage when he threw it incomplete. And now they will try about a 40-yard field goal. From Nick Robinson, he's quite a story, the freshman from Deland, Florida. They didn't really have a kicker they felt comfortable with. Mike Ayers went to the soccer coach. Give me the names of guys who are coming to Wofford who are soccer recruits but aren't going to play soccer. Robinson was one of them. Coach Ayers called Robinson, said, you want to try to be a football kicker? He said, yes, I'll try. He came, and he's their kicker. Does he have enough on that one? Yes! From 40 yards. On the last play of the first half, Wofford dominated throughout the half, but heads to the locker room tied at three.
Okay, so it was a good decision to go for it on fourth down, right, guys?
Good decision. And Trey Rodgers really sparked this offense. I expect him to start the second half for Wofford.
A 17-play drive yields the field goal that ties it. Halftime, Wofford and Delaware tied at three. Here's Matt Weiner. Some clouds have started to move in on a 36-degree afternoon here in Newark, Delaware, ready for the start of the second half. The winner goes to the 1AA National Championship game. Wofford and Delaware tied at three, and Jay Harvey kicks off for the Terriers of Wofford. And a good kick sends Sid Hagebrook into the end zone to take an E. Sean McDonough along with Rod Gilmore and Mike Godfrey. Gentlemen, Wofford outplayed for most of that half, just 85 yards of offense, but tied.
I think it's a good thing for Wofford. Delaware, remember, they blew out their first two playoff opponents in the first half. Now they're in the second half of a ball game, and I got to watch and see Andy Hall. How healthy will he be?
And I like the way Trey Rodgers came into this football game as the backup quarterback and shared duties, but he got the Wofford offense started.
Andy Hall had a good half, although he was throwing the ball not very deep down the field for the most part. Jermaine Bennett, the ball carrier on first down. He's out to the 24. Matt Nelson made the tackle with help from Josh Smith. Here's Holly Rowe.
Guys, talking to Delaware coach Casey Keeler at halftime, he said this is a key possession for them to start the second half. He said they did not finish in the red zone and that they were too patient. He said look for them to take some big shots here in the second half. Also, the health of his quarterback, Andy Hall, he said he's just fine. You'd never know anything's wrong with him.
He was 9 for 12 passing for 84 yards, an interception on a tip ball in the first half. He also rushed for 9 yards. He had a lot of time to throw here. There's the shot down the field, and it was almost intercepted. Alex Love got his hands on it. It was intended for David Bowler.
Sean, he took too long to get the ball down the field. The post was open, and Andy Hall just took too long to get the ball off. You see him set up here. He's a little cheap fake right here, and he sets it. Oh, ball's got to be thrown. Just waited too long to let the defensive corner cover that.
Well, these guys in the secondary for Wofford are really laying off. They're playing a three deep and sometimes a four deep coverage, giving a lot of room to the receivers because they don't want to be in man coverage.
Third down. And maybe a flag there. There is. That time Love was all over the back of Justin Long. Alex did not like the call, but he's flagged just the second penalty against Wofford in this game and just the third overall. John Sullivan's not been very busy.
The thing I don't like about that call is that the ball's thrown in the air. The corner's in a cover too.
Pass interference on the defense. 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
He's in a cover two rolled up. He sees the ball thrown. He goes to the spot where the ball is, and he's trying to beat the receiver to the spot. And I think you have a right when the ball's in the air to go to the ball.
Rodney, interference. It's interference all the way.
Yeah. He's got a right to go through the ball.
He can't go through the guy like that, though.
No, he can't make the contact.
If we had another angle, you'd see they were both going at different angles for the ball.
Interference.
Yeah. And about as obvious as it gets, I think. Out of the shotgun from the 30. Bennett, the 5-yard run. Tackled by Caton Bethay, who's a two-sport athlete. He's also an all-conference performer of the track team and indoor track with a shot put.
Well, you see Hall, 9 of 12, but everything's short. We talked about the patience he had. You heard Casey Keeler with Holly Rowe talking about taking some shots. They had miscues, a kickoff.
And now they have a long run by Bennett, and he is dragged down. Timmy Thrift hanging on for dear life to the shirt of Bennett. Slowed him down and then got help from Josh Smith, but the play goes to the 32-yard line, and it's a 32-yard gain.
Really a mistake made in the secondary by Craig Thomas, number 8. Use the boundary as the extra man. You can't get caught inside. Great effort by Thrift.
That's just that outside zone play. They got a great block at the point of attack that got into the corner.
That's the longest play from scrimmage in this game. Delaware on the move, first and 10, and moving along the left end of the offensive line. Trip Del Campo, the left tackle, junior from Rehoboth Beach, Delaware, moved.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
What Holly said is what all coaches believe. The first drive out, you set the tempo for the second half. Delaware, Casey Keeler wants to get this ball in the end zone. Doesn't want to settle for another 3 points.
Well, you know, I think there's an important point about that first drive, and we'll get to it after this play. I think you're absolutely right about that, Coach.
First and 15, as Hall goes out of the shotgun again. And throws complete to Brian Ingram, and now incomplete. The ball came out, looked like Ingram had it for a moment.
And Coach, going back to your point, that first drive of the third quarter, yes, it's important, but for players, it's important because your coaches give you adjustments at halftime. And when you go back out, you expect them to work. And if they don't work right away, you start losing a little confidence. So I think it's important to have those adjustments work when you go back out on the field.
You lose confidence?
A little bit. Coach said to do this, and
it's
not working.
We've worked all week, though. We just not to have it.
But the adjustments at halftime aren't all week.
Inside handoff out of the shotgun. Jermaine Bennett twisting and turning but gaining nothing. Teddy Whitaker the first hit, and then Alex Love came up from his safety spot to finish him off. Nice play by Whitaker from Burton, South Carolina.
Pretty good defense, Sean.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these guys will hit you. Wofford, they run real well. They've controlled the line of scrimmage, giving up some short passes, but that's not the big play.
Third down now, still 15 to go for a first down. They had an 18-play drive in their last possession of the first half and then missed the field goal. He's going for the end zone as a man, diving catch, and then it pops out. Brian Ingram had his hands on it, but couldn't hang on. And it'll be fourth down and 15.
And Andy Hall threw that one on time. Matt Nelson couldn't get over in time to make the play.
Got to catch that one.
All go routes, all receivers, 4 receivers down the field. That was a touchdown that got away. Andy Hall with a great throw under pressure.
Yeah, 4 deep receivers against 4 deep defensive backs.
Mike Weber punting for the first time today for Delaware. And that was almost a catastrophe for Wofford. Shield Wood really needed to get away from that. It kind of caught him on a bounce. He was fortunate that he played it cleanly. There is a flag down near the line of scrimmage. The ball marked at the 9-yard line. If it stays that way, it'll be a 28-yard punt officially. Holding against the Terriers. Mike Ayers, the Southern Conference Coach of the Year for the third time in the last 4 years, was an assistant at Wofford, left to become the head coach at East Tennessee State. And after 3 years there, when he turned that program around, came back to Wofford.
During the kick, post scrimmage kick enforcement, half the distance to the goal.
First Wofford and Delaware in a 3-3 tie. Early in the third quarter, Sean McDonough with Rod Gilmore, Mike Gottfried, and Holly Rowe. After a Delaware punt, Wofford will take over. And moments ago, very nearly the first touchdown of the game, but Brian Ingram couldn't hang on to the pass from Andy Hall.
Wofford's got to get McNair moving right here. Number four, the back. If you can get him moving, get him some yards, it'll open up the option.
From the four-yard line, they give it to number four, and he gets 4 yards out to the eight. Tackled by John Mulhern. With help from Sean Johnson, Mulhern, the third member of his family to play here at the University of Delaware. He has two brothers who have played here. Between the three of them, they had a streak of 117 games where none of them had ever missed a game. Mulhern got hurt earlier this year and missed one.
Look at all those free tickets.
They're making adjustments. They tend to run away from Sean Johnson. You saw him line up to the strong side. They may be audibilizing back to the weak side.
Right.
Rogers out near a first down at the 15. Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Guys, checking in with Wofford coach Mike Ayers before half started. He said that they felt like they did a great job in the first half of hunting and pecking. He said they feel like they know what will work here in the second half, and they've made those necessary adjustments. One of those, a new quarterback. You'll notice that Trey Rogers started the second half. They liked his momentum and his rhythm that ending the first.
And that's standard behavior for Wofford. Generally, they alternate the two in the first half and then decide who has the hot hand, if one of them does, and play that quarterback primarily in the second half. Wasn't their plan to play both quarterbacks, but they're very similar, and neither one of them has stepped ahead of the other. They both played well all season long. Devious Johnson lost the helmet, hung on to the football, and got a hard-earned two out to the 17. Mondo Davis made the tackle.
Well, we talked about, you heard Holly talk about the hunting and pecking. That was a big hit there. This is more of the two-back set power that we didn't see a lot of in the first half out of them. Remember, Coach, on their first couple series, they went wing T, stayed away from their option, and didn't show a lot of I formation power. We've seen a little bit of that now in the second half.
Johnson having trouble getting his helmet on. And he takes the pitch, and the play is thrown for a loss back to the 13-yard line. Sean Johnson and Tom Parks combined on the play. We take a look at the Home Depot coaching adjustments.
Well, the Delaware defense has been great at stopping the run, particularly inside. Coach talked about getting the fullback going. They've taken away the fullback. One adjustment for the second half, get it to the perimeter. Get the quarterback involved in the option game on the perimeter. That should help them in the second half.
This is not a good situation for Wofford. They're used to third and very short. Third down and 12. They threw six passes in the first half, matching the total they had thrown in the first two playoff games. They don't risk a throw here. Kevius Johnson gets into the 18. And Miner will have to punt.
If you're a wide receiver for Wofford, you better be tough because you're going to block the whole game.
Mm-hmm. You're really a wide blocker. Periodically a receiver. For the most part, a wide blocker.
You are a blocker, yeah. Blocker first.
Miner, as usual, had a terrific first half. This is his first punt going in this direction. And it doesn't matter. As he booms another one. Hagerbrook back to the 32 and retreating. Lots of running room on the far side of the field now. And he's out of bounds at the Wofford 41-yard line.
Well, you saw the speed. He is a track man. Has run the 223.17. You saw some speed there.
He had a 36-yard punt return in the first half to set up the field goal. This one 27 after a 50-yard punt. Some of the best quarterbacks in the NFL today played Division I AA college football. Steve McNair and Jay Fiedler among them. Fiedler there throwing a touchdown pass against the Big Red of Cornell Kurt Warner of Northern Iowa in a playoff game against Boston University. Terriers have since dropped football. Not because of that game. They actually won that game. And Rich Gannon of Delaware, running quarterback for the Fighting Blue Hens. The Patriots drafted him, wanted him to change positions. It's worked out pretty well for Rich as a quarterback in the NFL.
Jerry Burns was a friend of Coach Raymond's here and negotiated a trade to get Rich Gannon to the Vikings. And the rest is history.
Great field position again for Delaware, beginning first and 10 of the Wofford 41. Good fake by Hall, but Wofford in pursuit in a hurry. And Hall turns it into a gain, knocked down by Lee Basinger. At the 36-yard line, a gain of 5 for Hall.
I think this fake has become really popular ever since you saw Florida State and Chris Winkie pull that off a couple years ago. And this time it doesn't result in big play. You do that for the big play, and they didn't get it this time.
Calls from Shiraz, South Carolina, which is the hometown of Fisher DeBerry, the Air Force coach, who is one of the most famous Wofford College graduates. He still has a home in Shiraz, and he sees him there from time to time. The ball came out from the hands of Antoine Jenkins, but they whistle him down. There was also a flag that fell on the field, but I think the official didn't mean to throw it. He quickly scooped it back up along the far sideline.
Sean, I thought that was a fumble.
There is no flag on the play. There is no flag on the play.
Let's see if it's a fumble or not, Rodney. Timmy Thrift. Oh, that ball looked like it was out.
Yeah, that ball was out.
Delaware keeps possession, third down and 6. They need to get to the 31-yard line. Nearly midway through the third quarter. Pump fake. Hall wanted to go deep. It was well covered. Now he throws on the run. Incomplete. Looking for David Bowler.
Rodney, when I watch this, I think you got the deep post against the Wofford defense, but you don't have the takeoff because that was covered.
Yeah, they played a two-deep coverage, taking away the outside deep routes. And you did have something down the middle. And that's where the weakness that usually is with the two deep coverage.
Another good job by Wofford's defense.
Mike Weber to punt for the second time, both here in this quarter. He's a former walk-on on scholarship and the son of a coach. And it's downed at the 9-yard line by Delaware's Jamie Rotundo. Rotunda downing a 27-yard. Now midway through the third quarter, Wofford and Delaware still tied at 3. Wofford still under 100 yards of offense with 98 for the day. They've been outplayed, but they're in a 3-3 tie. Misdirection, and it's Kevious Johnson. Out to the 11, a gain of 2. Here's Holly Rowe.
Offense has admitted that the crowd noise is becoming a problem. On their last series where they were forced to punt, they came to the sideline and said, "We don't know what audible Trey Rogers changed to. The wide receivers had no idea what the play was." Take in mind, Wofford plays in front of about an average of 9,000 fans a game. Delaware plays in front of an average of about 20,000 fans a game. So the crowd noise starting to affect Wofford's communication on offense.
Delaware, the only 1AA program that has averaged 20,000 or more each of the last 5 years. This really is a big-time atmosphere at this level, one level down from Division 1A football. Rogers kept it. Went out to the 15. Mondo Davis made the stop.
Sean, when you look at these big splits, I want to show you the split between the guard and the tackle for Wofford. What that is trying to do is to make somebody declare to get in this gap right here. That's the B gap right there. Who's going to get the dive? And so by that split, they're making him declare early for the quarterback to read it.
Wants to throw as Shield Wooden one-on-one coverage, and it was almost picked off by Sidney Hagebrook, the junior from Atlanta, the three-year starter, and he's the only player in the history of the Atlantic 10 Conference who was the conference rookie of the year. He did that in 2001.
We settle into a very nice defensive battle. Both squads are playing great defense. The pass coverage on that play in particular, outstanding.
But Delaware's got the best field position chance. I mean, they are taking advantage of the great field position their defense and special teams have given.
Miner helping to neutralize that with good punting, although Hagebrook has had two long punt returns. He has no chance to run that one back as it bounced out of bounds at the 47-yard line, a 37-yard punt. 3-3 the score. We're in the third quarter in the Division I-AA semifinal matchup. Back in Newark, Delaware, Tubby Raymond Field at Delaware Stadium, Sean McDonough with Rod Gilmore, Mike Gottfried, and Holly Rowe. Our producer, Scott Matthews, director, John McDonough, delighted to have you with us. The winner will play for the national championship on Friday night in Chattanooga, Tennessee. First appearance ever in the 1AA playoffs for Wofford. Delaware hasn't been in the championship game since 1982. They've had the edge in play, decided edge in play, but it's been miscues, missed opportunities, the story of the day for Delaware. Referee asking the band not to play during play.
That seems like a reasonable request.
For the instrument playing Fighting Blue Hens have been silenced. Hall 0 for his last five passing. Hands it off to Jermaine Bennett with room as he bounces outside. Inside the 35 and pushed out of bounds at the 28-yard line. Ryan Steele, the senior from York, South Carolina, pushed him out after a 25-yard gain.
Well, you see the great blocking they got right out there to the edge. Once you get the block on the end, you got a chance to get to the corner. This is a nice bounce outside, and then they also tie up the linebacker, Timmy Thrift, as well. If you can do that, you can bounce it outside.
Another great opportunity for Delaware. Here's Bennett again. Down to the 23. They haven't taken advantage of a number of opportunities. The key plays today involve miscues for Delaware. Down in scoring area, a deflected pass that was picked off, a missed 30-yard field goal by Brad Shushman. And this looked to be the first touchdown of the game, but Brian Ingram couldn't hang on.
Well, as Coach mentioned, those opportunities, they've had a short field. They got to convert now or else the tide will turn eventually.
Bennett up to 101 yards rushing now, so he has set the single season rushing record for Delaware. And he'll get a couple of more on that carry to the 21-yard line before he ran into Matt Nelson and Lee Basinger. He needed 90 yards starting the day. And with a couple more there, he's up to 1,477. And congratulations to Jermaine.
I'm glad they didn't throw him off the football team. And Sean, I think the hitting today's ball game, it's been as good as any Division I game I've had all year.
These are two teams demonstrating why they are playoff teams of this caliber. They caught Wofford in a blitz, and Bennett almost took it to the end zone, tripped up by Ryan Steele, the last line of defense. First down, Delaware, inside the 17-yard line.
Now this is where Delaware has struggled in the red zone. They haven't been able to convert much at all today, just the field goal. And part of that problem is because Wofford doesn't give them anything. The field shrinks. They play a zone down here, makes it hard for them to throw the ball down here.
Keep all running goes back to the shotgun. Pardon me, Mike.
Keep running Bennett.
They do. It'll be on an inside handoff, but it's a pass. Hall on target to Boulder. Another first down. He's fighting for the end zone, and they finally get him on the ground near the one-yard line. Alex Love and Matt Nelson battling to take down Boulder, the transfer from the University of Southern California, a 16-yard gain.
And that ball was a bullet, and Boulder has played much of the season with a broken bone in his wrist or thumb area. He caught that bullet, used his big body to shield off the defender. Look at that. That's just a nice entry pass in basketball. Post up, catch the ball inside.
Major league throw by Hall.
Boulder will need surgery on that wrist when the season's over. From inside the two, first and goal. Hall gives it to Bennett. Touchdown, Delaware. Brad Shushman, who's made 39 straight PATs. And had the extra point out of the first touchdown of the game, and it is good. First touchdown of the ball game scored by Jermaine Bennett on this day on which he has become the single season rushing leader at Delaware. Six play drive, 53 yards, 10-3, fighting Blue Hens. Four straight 100-yard rushing games now for Jermaine Bennett. His two-yard touchdown, the first of the game. Delaware leads 10-3. 17th rushing touchdown this year for Bennett.
It's got to be awfully sweet for him after being a backup for three seasons, being frustrated, almost kicked off the team, and he responds with a senior season that was just has been incredible. Team leader.
He made the big run that got him down there, too. He broke it outside, an inside handoff, good vision, skated to the outside, set the whole scoring drive up.
Shushman had a little bit of trouble teeing up the ball. They have had problems this year, Delaware, on kickoff coverage. Three times this season, Shushman has been called upon to make touchdown-saving tackles. Here's Kevious Johnson from the 11. Excellent coverage there. He got banged down right near the 21-yard line. Kyle Campbell and Roger Brown down there covering the kickoff.
When you watch this, watch Bennett come out of the backfield, and the linebacker's going to jump him, number 44, Thrift. Now, he doesn't get wide, which opens up the post on the backside. So pretty good design football play by the offensive coordinator, Kurt Shiraka.
Again, poor field position for Wofford, and Johnson can't get out of the backfield. Drop for a loss back near the 20 by Sean Johnson, who has demonstrated today why he is the Atlantic 10 Conference Defensive Player of the Year. Wofford and Delaware. Delaware has owned the edge in play throughout the game. They lead just 10-3 after a touchdown moments ago. Wofford struggling on offense. For the season, averaging 268 yards per game rushing, they have just 79 yards rushing and just 102 total yards. Trey Rogers setting up a screen, has a man wide open. It's Adam Regenthal, the tight end, just his second catch of the year. Just the third by a tight end for Wofford all season long. It goes to the 29, and they'll need three more for a first down.
Can you imagine that? Tight end in college football, and that's your second catch.
And one of them was on a fake field goal.
Doesn't say much about your hands, though. But it's the offense. It's not his ability to receive the football, but every now and then you got to have a little sugar.
Each of the previous catches by a tight end went for a 14-yard touchdown. And McNair has the first down. Needed the 32, got the 33. Mondo Davis made the tackle on the student body president. Ed Wofford, very good academic institution. School, as we mentioned, the smallest in Division 1A or 1AA football, 1,100 students. The average SAT score is about 1,250. On the football team, it's 1,170. You have to be a good student to get in there. Coach Ayers tells recruits, if you want easy, don't come here. It's hard in the football program, and it's hard academically. Rogers out to the 37-yard line.
I don't know about you two, but 1241 the SAT, I think all three of us couldn't get 1241.
We might together. Not have that combined. Yeah, I know what you meant.
You know, you talk about the SATs and the playoffs. Keep in mind, these guys have all been in finals.
Yeah, both teams had finals all this week. Disrupted a lot of practice schedules. Matt Nelson told us yesterday he had a total of 4 hours sleep in the previous three nights. Took a final each day this past week. McNair out to the 39-yard line. One out of six men, the male students on the Wofford campus, is on the football team. They only have about 550 male students. One out of six are members of the football team. If you applied that ratio at the University of Michigan, they'd have more than 1,800 guys on the football team.
Wow.
Third down and four. Under a minute to go in the third quarter.
Can they find 96 and then go the opposite way?
They're going to play three quarters of this game in under 2 hours of actual time. Sean Johnson again penetrating. And through Kevious Johnson for a loss. And the Terriers will punt.
But Sean Johnson, here he is away from the play, but he is so quick, he still gets to the opposite side to make the play.
He can dominate a game, Rodney. He's dominating this football game right now.
Transferred from Duke for just this last year. He graduated from Duke with a degree in biological anthropology and anatomy. Hagebrook muffed the punt, but got it back at the 11-yard line. Another booming boot by Miner, 46 yards. Johnson wanted to transfer to Fordham, where his brother Travis is on the football team, but they don't take fifth-year seniors as transfers, so the Fordham coach, Dave Clausen, recommended Delaware. And here Johnson is at Delaware, and they're very happy to have him. That's the end of the third quarter in under 2 hours, and Delaware leads Wofford 10-3. Ready for the start of the fourth quarter here in Newark, Delaware. The Fighting Blue Hen fans hope that they're 15 minutes away from a trip to the national championship game in Chattanooga on Friday night. The rare times that Delaware started with poor field position from their own 11. Antoine Jenkins trying to earn them some room, but gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's all. Tonight it's the Heisman Trophy presentation brought to you by Wendy's. That's at 8 Eastern time on ESPN. Reese Davis, Trev Alberts, and Mark May live from Grand Central Station. Reese will join Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, and Kirk Herbstreit at the Yale Club for live interviews with the finalists, family members, and coaches. The finalists Jason White of Oklahoma, Eli Manning of Ole Miss, Larry Fitzgerald of Pittsburgh, and Chris Perry, the running back from Michigan. Second and 10. Hall keeps, skips through the line of scrimmage, and gets out to the 18-yard line. That'll bring up third down and three. Here are the finalists again. I mentioned I would vote for Larry Fitzgerald. You still want Ben Roethlisberger. He's not going to be there. So you think tonight, Mike, they're going to open the envelope and say the winner is Ben Roethlisberger. We'll send him the trophy out there to Miami of Ohio.
Mobile. He's down
to Mobile. He's going to be
Ben
your
Ben Roethlisberger is the best player in college football. Keep this tape for 10 years. I want this tape to be back after he proves himself in the NFL.
Yep.
And then you guys will understand what I meant.
Yep. It's not about the
Keep
NFL.
The tape. Keep the tape.
Brian Ingram wide open. And Brian has a first down out to the 31-yard line. A big third down conversion for Delaware on third and three. They get 13 and a first down.
Well, here you'll see another quarterback who may not be as good as Ben, but there's a nice throw across the middle to pick up the first
he
down.
He can't be as good as Ben. Ben's the best. Mike
Ben's the best. And
I like
the tape.
Eli Manning, I think, is the best quarterback going right now, and Fitzgerald is the best player.
But you said you'd vote for Jason White.
No, I didn't. Don't misquote me.
On that.
Don't misquote me. What I said was Jason White will win, but I would vote for Eli Manning.
Antoine Jenkins, the ball carrier, out to the 34-yard line.
You kind of are all over the board right
What's
there.
Hard to understand about that? I think that other people will vote for Jason White.
And I agree
I would
with
vote
you.
For Eli Manning.
Yes.
That's not so difficult.
When you explain it like that, it's not.
Second down and eight. Already 2 minutes off the clock here in the fourth quarter. Walker just can't tilt the field position back in its favor here in the second half. They've been playing the long field. This is one of the few times Delaware's had to play the long field. And the officials stopped the play now, stopped the clock, as Josh Smith was a little slow to get up, and he's going off, the junior from Greer, South Carolina. Not a bad student, Josh, 3.85 in biology.
3.85 in biology. Wow. I'd have a hard time coaching these guys.
Smith looks a little wobbly. I think he went helmet to helmet there with Antoine Jenkins.
Wait till you get the emails from all your former players.
I had some good students. These guys are all 3-8s.
Yeah, on both sides. Really two very good academic football teams here. Both put their time in the classroom. Hall called a timeout. It's another big third down upcoming. Third down and three for Delaware from their own 39-yard line. When we come back, the Fighting Blue Hens lead 10-3 in the fourth. Along with Holly Rowe, Sean McDonough, Mike Gottfried, and Rod Gilmore, delighted to have you with us. Delaware with a one-touchdown lead. 12-18 left in the fourth quarter, and the Blue Hens with third down and three from their own 38-yard line. Nearly about 2.5 to go as Andy Hall goes out of the shotgun. And he hands it off to Jenkins, and this will be close. Looks like he got it with that surge right at the end. Matt Nelson and Ryan Steele up from the safety spots to try to help out, but Jenkins is a load at 240 pounds, and it is a first down for Delaware.
This is a big first down. Yeah, they've taken the ball from the shadows of their own goalpost out to the midfield area. That has kept Wofford from getting good field position so far, Coach.
That's my guy Matt Nelson came up and made that hit. He is an outstanding tackler.
And they think he's the best defensive player they've ever had at Wofford. There's Jenkins. Really an interesting program at Wofford. They do a lot of unconventional things. Nelson, earlier this year, asked Coach Ayers if at halftime of their homecoming game he could not go into the locker room to meet with the coaches. Instead, could he stay on the field because his girlfriend, Rhea DeJesus, the volleyball player at Wofford, was in the homecoming court. And the coach said, well, if it's fairly well in hand at halftime, I'll let you do it. They were comfortably ahead, so he stayed on the field.
In full uniform.
I asked him if he got a kiss at halftime. He said, no, none of that.
Here's Hall, and he carries for another first down. The coach Ayers himself, a black belt in karate, was walking across the campus one day, heard some noise in the field house, walked in, saw Master Cho teaching a karate class. He watched for a while. He went up later and said, can I be in your karate class? Said yes. They got to the point where he got totally involved in it, became a black belt. Now he teaches karate in the spring semester on the Wofford campus. There's a man who was hired as head coach over a milkshake at a dairy bar in Asheville, North Carolina in 1988 with the athletic director at the time, Danny Morrison, now the commissioner of the Southern Conference. First and 10 for Delaware from the 47. Hall will take off again and not get as far this time. Just a yard. Lee Basinger made the tackle. So I told Mike Ayers, we will not be criticizing him on this telecast, and the videotape will tell you why.
That'll get the attention of your players.
Whoa. You're not going to mouth off to this coach. Don't miss his practice. He said it really helps him as a stress reliever in coaching.
Most important thing is, I wouldn't want to be the president that fires him.
Well, he doesn't have to worry about the former president, because the former president of Wofford, Joel Lassane, is on his coaching staff now. He retired after 28 years as president of Wofford in 2000 and is the tight ends coach on a volunteer basis. To the 45 goes Antoine Jenkins. Justin Franklin made the tackle. President Lassane had been an assistant football coach when he was a professor at Wofford in the mid-60s. Had to give it up when he became president of the college, but now that he is retired from that post, he's on the coaching staff. Jenkins limps off. And it's third down for Delaware from the 45. They need to meet the 37-yard line. And Hall will go out of the gun again. And the time runs under 9.5 minutes left. Hall using just about all the play clock. It was snapped at 4. Hall throws on the run as a man open. Is it a catch? Yes. David Bowler managed to stay in bounds and make the catch. at the 27-yard line. First and 10, Delaware.
And that play was huge. That play kept Wofford from getting the ball back. And watch the way he makes his play. Just enough air to give his man Bowler, who's 6'2", the opportunity to pick it out of the air and keep the chains moving.
And Bowler's the leading receiver on this team with 51 receptions coming into this game. None more important than that one because that kept the drive alive.
18-yard gain. Caden Bethea, the nose tackle, had a chance to trip up Hall, and he lunged for his ankles but didn't get him. Now the inside handoff to Bennett. He's down at the 23. At the very least, they're in field goal range now, and a field goal would be potentially fatal to Wofford given the time situation and their reliance on the ground game to get back into it.
Yeah, Sean, I agree with you in their offense. And Casey Keeler told his team the other day, he said, Monday at 4, one team's going to collect their equipment and one team's going to make a plans for Chattanooga. So his football team right now is banking on making those travel plans.
All the veteran quarterback alertly again using almost all the play clock. It's a 2 as he took the snap. There's Bennett powering down inside the 17-yard line. Another first down for Delaware. Timmy Thrift made the tackle. The winner of this game advances to the championship game, which you'll see at 7 o'clock Friday night on ESPN2 from Chattanooga, Tennessee. They'll meet the winner of the game going on right now between Florida Atlantic and Colgate.
And Colgate, John McDonough's dad went to Colgate,
our director.
Yes.
What a season they've had. Undefeated are the Red Raiders of Colgate as a non-scholarship program. First and 10 from the 17. High formation now, and Bennett still on his feet, driving near another first down. Brian Steele finally able to pull down Bennett.
One of the changes Delaware made coming into this ball game was to go more to the two-back set. They have been a one-back team with the spread offense. Today you see them a lot more two-back I formation. Sean Blyler as the fullback, number 22, who was a wing back here, and he's getting more playing time in the backfield today than he has all season.
This drive started at their own 11. It started at the first play of this quarter, so it's gone nearly 8 minutes. 15th play of the drive. Bennett has the first down to the 5-yard line.
It's almost like you feel like they're trying to break the will of this defensive football team right here with this drive. And again, Kirk Soroka, Araka, a very good offensive coordinator, has had a good designed offense. In the second half, Holly Rowe talked about the first drive being important. The adjustments was made by Casey Keeler and Soroka, and they have really played well here in the second half on offense.
First and goal. 131 yards rushing for Bennett now, 9 away from his career high. He gets the call again. Touchdown, Delaware! And there's a flag down after the touchdown.
Going to get it on Bennett for dancing.
But he danced nicely into that hole. A lot of patience and then getting to the outside.
French fourth for life. On the blue. Touchdown still stands.
We're going to elect to take this on the extra pointer on the kickoff.
And they ought to take it on the kickoff.
Yeah, they could use some good field position.
Casey Keeler, the coach, giving Bennett an earful about the penalty. Celebrating a little bit early,
yeah,
6 minutes to go.
Dance tonight. Don't dance now.
Well, that was a championship caliber drive. 16 plays, 89 yards, 8:19 off the clock, 14 running plays, just 2 passes, and they were 3 out of 3 on third down. Brad Shushman adds the extra point. 6:43 to go in Newark, Delaware. And the Fighting Blue Hens lead Wofford College 17-3. There's an actual Fighting Blue Hen, a couple of them, in fact. The football version pairing very nicely in this Division I AA semifinal game. Delaware leading Wofford 17-3.
There's UD.
Yeah.
UD.
The mascot.
As in University of Delaware, UD.
I think we got it right.
Okay.
In Newark. Right?
Newark.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't say Newark. This is Newark, Delaware.
Okay. If you're saying the other thing, you're in trouble. Right here.
Yeah, they don't like it around here. Okay. Why should they?
We're all learning to speak
the name of the fine bird here. Great venue for college football. Cushman's kickoff after the penalty comes down near the 40-yard line, and it's run back inside Delaware territory by Jeff Sullivan, a backup fullback. So for the first time in this half, very good field position for Wofford, and they need it. They'll start at the 49. They're running out of time on the Wofford sideline, down 17-3. They've managed just 120 yards of offense against a very good Delaware defense. From the 49-yard line of Delaware, Trey Rogers still at quarterback, and he got pulled down by John Mulhern. And then after the play ended, all kinds of flags flying, four flags on the field, and they move in quickly to get Sean Johnson away from Chad Bentley. Well, they sort it out. We'll check in with Matt Weiner.
All right, Sean, Colgate could be a quarter away from a date with the Blue Hens. Chris Brown back to pass in the shotgun. Second of the day, this one finds Dwayne Long to make it 30-10. Florida Atlantic has just scored to cut it to a 30-16 margin.
Right here on the offense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. Will be second down.
A very costly penalty and very uncharacteristic of Wofford way after the play was over. Bentley came in and delivered the hit on Leon Clark. Fourth penalty of the game for Wofford. They had committed a total of four in their first two playoff games. Rogers on the rollout. Throws to Sheil Wood. And he's down at the 45-yard line. Tackled by Dave Camburn.
A well-designed play out there, giving the outside receiver just a stop route and then letting the inside receiver run the corner off so the stop route is there.
Abandon the plan right now. You got to throw the football.
And the whistle stopped the play and a timeout. No indication yet from the referee Sullivan which
Delaware,
team called timeout. Delaware
did. Second timeout of the half.
They have one timeout left. Wofford has all three, and the Terriers will likely need them, trailing by two touchdowns with under 6 minutes to go. Picked for Wofford out of the Delaware timeout. They're in four down territory. Dara, the Terriers trailing by two touchdowns. Kevious Johnson, they weren't fooled by that misdirection. A loss of two. Mark Moore made the tackle, the former walk-on, who's become a standout linebacker here. Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Guys, an interesting decision right here for Wofford to continue with quarterback Trey Rogers. Of the two quarterbacks, he is the least proficient thrower. Coming into the playoffs, he had a negative 66% efficiency rating yet to complete a ball coming into this game. So an interesting decision to stay with him instead of their more throwing quarterback, Jeff Zolman, who's on the sidelines.
They did their complete one in the playoffs. They did throw over 303 yards in the regular season. He's in trouble on fourth down and sacked, and they'll turn it over on downs. Sean Johnson again.
And Sean Johnson has just been dominant. They can't block him.
I think they should go ahead and give him that Buck Buchanan Award right now for the best defensive player in Division I AA football, because if there's somebody better than him, I want to see that guy.
Well, he goes through a double team right there and makes the tackle. He's just been unbelievable today.
He transferred in from Duke After completing 4 years there, he just got tired of losing. Had 1 year left of eligibility. Duke was 2-32 over the 3 seasons that he played. So he thought about quitting completely, wanted to keep playing. He was first team all ACC last year against that great competition. Jermaine Bennett trying to put the finishing touches on a great day. That's a new career high for a single game rushing for Jermaine Bennett as he rambled down to the 23-yard line. A 27-yard gain, he's up to 163 yards rushing.
But being able to run the ball in the fourth quarter when you have a lead is key. And they've done that, Delaware has. It's broken the will, broken the spirit of Wofford, and Casey Keeler loves that. He's an old linebacker. He knows that a physical game is the way you finish it. You pound them. And that's what Delaware's done this afternoon in the fourth quarter.
Under 5 minutes to go now. From the 23, first and 10, they'll stick with Bennett. He's down at the 20. Here's Matt Weiner.
All right, Sean, we showed you Colgate's touchdown a moment ago. Don't count out the Isles just yet. Jared Allen to Aaron Sanchez, his fullback, rumbling. 35 yards inside the five, sets up Allen one more time. Doug Parker, his second touch of the day. Start of the fourth, lead is cut to 13.
And the winner of that game will play the winner of this one in the national championship game in Chattanooga on Friday night. Delaware in great position here with the ball, leading by two touchdowns, now under 4 minutes to go. And Hall alertly using all the play clock. And it's Bennett for a yard to the 19. Tackled by Justin Franklin.
You know, we talk about championship games and Casey Keeler, the coach of Delaware. And this is a guy who went to 5 title games when he was a coach at Rowan and lost them all. And when he got hired here, he said they were going to get to the championship game sooner rather than later. And he may have them there next week.
In his second season as head coach here at his alma mater, still wears his championship ring from his playing days here when they won the Division II title. Never won the 1AA championship. They'll have a chance to play for it Friday night, barring a major turn of events. Bennett stopped short of the first down. And what do you do now if you coach Keeler? Field goal, put your 3 scores up, but a first down does you a lot of good too.
I think I'll run the ball and go for the first down right here.
You don't want a block kick or anything like that to just give them a freaky situation where they get some points. Just keep running.
And Wofford has called timeout, leaving the Terriers with 2.
You know, Sean, I want to say about Nate Woody, the defensive coordinator for Wofford. I thought his defense played well, played championship football. But the offense just couldn't get going. But you got to give Delaware's defense credit. I think Delaware's defense is really outstanding, and they got an outstanding player.
I think you're right, and Wofford never got the short field. They never got the chance to get the ball where they only had to go 30, 40, 50 yards. They always had to go the long distance. Delaware finally took advantage of the short field in the third quarter, and that made the difference in the ballgame.
When you talk about these playoffs, Delaware held Southern Illinois to 7 points, 164 yards rushing. They were averaging 39 points and 274 yards rushing, and they held Northern Iowa last week to just 7 points and 164 yards of total offense. So the defense has been the key for Casey Keeler here in the playoffs.
Sean Johnson is a dominating player. I think if I was the coach at Duke, I'd have cried when he left, because you don't have many defensive linemen anywhere in the country. And when you lose one with the ability that Sean Johnson has, I mean, it's Delaware's Christmas came early for Delaware.
And not just to lose him, but to lose him when he has only 1 year of eligibility left after you've had him. And that's an odd situation for a player to leave when he's had that much success, to leave for one final season.
Fourth and a short 2. It's Bennett heading for the end zone. Touchdown, Delaware.
Thank you.
travel agents right now here in Newark.
They'll be heading to Chattanooga Friday night to play for a national championship.
They got to call the professors as well because they've got finals scheduled next week. They've got to make some arrangements.
Yeah, take the professors with them.
The extra point by Shushman after a 15-yard touchdown run by Jermaine Bennett. 23, Mike Bluehens. We're back in Newark, Delaware, where the celebration has begun. The homestanding Fighting Bluehens just 2:42 away from the national championship game, and the reality is set in on the Wofford sideline. They came in at 12-1. 12 straight wins after an opening loss at Air Force. Dreaming in their first appearance in the 1AA playoffs of going to the championship game, and it's not going to happen this year.
Home field advantage, big in the playoffs.
Delaware will have advanced with three home games. Kevius Johnson took the kickoff and did not make the 20 once again. Jamie Rotundo's had a couple of big plays on special teams, made the play, but nobody's had a bigger day than Jermaine Bennett. 31 carries, 186 yards, and three touchdowns. Kirk Shiraka, the offensive coordinator, said yesterday, we need to get him 20-plus touches. Well, they achieved that goal, and it worked out just as he had hoped.
Pretty good looking back, Rodney. We've seen a lot of games this year. This guy's as good a looking as most running backs I've seen all year.
He's got really good feet and he runs hard. He made a really big play in the third quarter that led to the first touchdown.
Rogers, the late pitch to Kevius Johnson, and one of the few good gainers today for Wofford. That's out to the 39-yard line where Mike Adams made the tackle, a 22-yard gain. The 140 last week was a career high. It has been surpassed, and they've already printed it up in the local paper. University of Delaware will indeed be heading to the title game.
That's pretty good. Mike Adams is on the cover, but you could put Bennett or you could put Sean Johnson on the cover too.
Sheil Wood, the catch, and he goes out of bounds.
Always wondered what they would have done with those if they lost.
You burn them and you pull out the other
one to see it, right?
They're pretty sure that victory is in the bag before they
go to printing press.
You would think, or at least they wouldn't print very many. It'll be the first trip, as you saw, to the final game since 1982. The last three appearances, including in 2000, their most recent appearance, they bailed out of the playoffs in this game, in the semifinal game. J.R. McNair, the ball carrier.
Give a lot of credit to Dave Cohen and his defense and what they've done. Now, they have faced some pretty good running teams before, including Navy, and really kind of shut them down. But what they did against the number five ranked rushing team in Division I AA today, just outstanding.
And you mentioned this coaching staff for Delaware. It's kind of a hodgepodge group. On third and short, they're stopped. They'll have to go for it on fourth down. McNair was stopped. Casey Killer didn't know some of these assistants very well at all. Dave Cohen had been at Delaware with Tubby Raymond, left to go to Fordham with a great young coach, Dave Clawson. And then wasn't all that interested in coming back to Delaware unless he was going to be a coordinator. And he told us yesterday, I think I got the job because Tubby Raymond told Casey Killer that I was the best recruiter he had ever worked with in all of his centuries of coaching.
Yeah, you're right. Centuries. And Tubby's here tonight.
36 years as head coach here.
And he's
great
job.
Proud man.
But I think both staffs, I've been impressed with the respect that both staffs have for the other guys because they know they're really good coaches.
I think what Casey Keeler's telling him is we'll do the Gatorade bucket if we win the national championship.
Yeah, did you see that? He ran away from it. He's still in good shape, the old linebacker.
Well, he's cold, too. This is not the time for the Gatorade.
Wofford with a timeout, and you have the feeling they'll be back. Here's a program now, Mike, that is on a roll. 9-3 last year. They really felt that they got shafted by not getting into the playoffs. They had two wins over teams ranked in the top five. So they said, we're going to guarantee it this year by winning the Southern Conference and getting the automatic bid. And they did. Went undefeated through their conference and undefeated against all 1AA competition. This is a school that when Mike Ayers came was an NAIA. Made the jump to Division II, then the jump to 1AA. They told him, you're crazy. You'll never win a game in 1AA. And in their ninth year in 1AA, they were one win away from playing for a championship.
And that conference, I'm sorry, Mike, that conference had been dominated by Georgia Southern for so long. And these guys have pushed Georgia Southern aside now.
Yeah, I was going to say the Southern Conference to me is really good. And it's probably one of the top Division I AA conferences in the country.
Catch made by Curtis Nash. And that's Everybody another first down for Wofford. Roger Brown made the tackle. Andy Hall sending along hello to his folks. His dad, Wendell's a pilot who's been to every game this year but bothered by the flu this week and did not make the trip. So we send our best wishes along to Wendell Hall back there in Shaw, South Carolina. Andy told us it's a great place to live if you're a NASCAR fan, about 20 minutes each from Darlington and Rockingham. Right on the North Carolina border. Moving along the line of scrimmage here. 59 seconds left.
Who's your player of the game here? If you had
Sean
to pick
Johnson.
A player,
Sean.
Sean Johnson, do you think he dominated the game? How about you, Rodney?
Every tape I watched for Delaware in preparation for this game, he dominated every game we watched him play.
How about you?
I'd agree with that. I think Johnson and Bennett were the two dominant players. Get your vote.
Ben Roethlisberger.
I'm going to throw Andy Hall in there because Andy Hall played injured and did some great things. So I think all three of them.
Rodgers knocked down at the 26-yard line. Ryan McDermott got enough of him to knock him down. Johnson already with his pads off. And they're checking out the headline with Mike Adams. They call Adams Pops because he's the senior member of that group. Pops gets to read the paper first. That's usually the way it is. Through the hands of Nash, an incomplete pass with 26 seconds to go. There's our Pontiac high performance moment, and what a great performance by Bennett. Jermaine sealing it with his third touchdown of the ball game. And you like that, hand the ball to the ref after he got the unsportsmanlike conduct penalty earlier for a celebration. Out of the gun on third down. Rodgers throws too low for Curtis Nash. 23 seconds to go. Our clock on the screen is not in sync here. One of the older facilities in college football with the official scoreboard clock. This is a 50-year-old stadium. Oh, they're trying to do the Gatorade bucket again. Looked like Coach Keeler was pretty firm about not wanting the Gatorade bucket.
Hey, you see, there's one guy shaking his head going, nah, don't do it, guys. Don't do it.
As you said, Rodney, he's been to the championship game in Division III 5 times without winning. He wants to win it all. Here's Rodgers trying to get Wofford on the board again with a touchdown, their first of the game if they could pull it off. He's out of bounds at the 9, a 17-yard gain and a first down with 15 seconds to go. This season will end for Wofford at 12-2. The coach Mike Ayers has become an icon on the Wofford campus. They have everything in place to sustain this great facility. The Carolina Panthers use their facilities as their training camp, so everything is NFL caliber. That has really helped them upgrade the program. Jerry Richardson, the owner of the Panthers, is a Wofford alum. McNair gets nothing, and Wofford will call a timeout. They'll fight to the very end and postpone the celebration for the time being. Fans here don't like it. They also don't like the fact that the horses have come on the field to prevent the students from storming the field. We'll get you to the end of the Colgate Florida Atlantic game as soon as we're done here in Newark. Casey Keeler, when he took the job, he talked openly about championships. Some people cringe. The program was a little bit down. Their consecutive non-winning seasons, the 4-6 in the last year under Coach Raymond, the 6-6 last year and the first year under Coach Keeler, were the first consecutive non-winning season since 1960 and 61 at Delaware. But this is a program with everything in place to win national championships. Second and goal from the 10. Wofford is out of timeouts. Rodgers throws to the end zone, and it's broken up. It hit Mark Moore in the back, it appeared. And they did get him with the bucket. He's not too pleased about it, it seems.
Yeah, he'll be happy tonight when he gets when he gets home. But
the students now are storming the field with 3 seconds to go. They got around the horses. We got an offsides on the defense there. The offensive line of horses never moved.
The horses.
Now, why are the horses there?
Here's where they're at. They're there. The students are over there.
Yes, the rest of the field is fair over there. Don't go there. What about the other goalpost? All they have is police officers at the other end. Coach Keeler asking the fans to get off the field. And many of the students and their fellow fans running a reverse back for the end zone seats.
Horses still have not moved.
No. They've not been drawn offside. They are protecting that goalpost. I think the other goalpost might be in greater jeopardy with just three or four police officers who are not on horseback at the other end. One last chance for Wofford when play resumes. There is a flag down here. You wonder if Delaware will be penalized for the fans running on the field.
I would say it's a good chance for that to happen.
For too many men on the field?
Too many men and women.
This will likely be the last play. Third and goal from the 5. Wofford wants desperately to score a touchdown here. Rodgers throws to the end zone, touchdown. Well, will there be an extra point? Because here come the fans again. Brian Rice scored the touchdown. I'm not sure there'll be an extra point.
This is a do-over. The fans got to do it over again.
And the referee, John Sullivan, just waved off the extra point. He shook hands with Mike Ayers, and Ayers doesn't seem to mind, so the final score will be Delaware 24 and Wofford 9. Delaware advances to the 1AA National Championship game for the first time since 1982. And Wofford's season ends at 12-2. And gentlemen, a well-earned victory. Delaware really controlled this game from start to finish, and Wofford did well to hang in there into the second half.
An impressive performance on both sides of the ball for Delaware. Offensively, have the running threat. Andy Hall's a very good passing quarterback on defense. Sean Johnson's a guy that can dominate the game.
And it was the third quarter, the field position, really the difference, really the key. Delaware eventually took advantage of the opportunities they had with the short field. Once they got the touchdown and the 7-point lead, that really changed the complexion of the ball game, and then they iced it in the fourth quarter.
Well, without the horses at this end of the field, the students are on the goalpost, and let's hope that nobody gets seriously hurt. It's a very dangerous situation. Now the officers on horseback making their way to the other end to try to break that up. But down come the goalposts before the horses and police officers can get there. Or at least they're tilted. Jermaine Bennett, 31 carries, 186 yards and 3 touchdowns. Andy Hall passed for 130 and rushed for 31. And the defense outstanding is Wofford at 207 total yards. Back in a moment. Delaware a winner 24-9. School record 14th victory of the season for the Fighting Blue Hens. And they really controlled the play from start to finish. And they're trying to restore order near the goalpost. The police now in control of that situation, but the goalpost and upright did come down. And what a day for Jermaine Bennett, guys. Nearly thrown off the football team by both Tubby Raymond and Casey Keeler. stayed in the program and had the greatest day of his career in the biggest game in which he's ever played, the one here today.
Yeah, give Delaware's offense credit for wearing down the defense of Wofford. Wofford played well, and Coach Whitty, the defensive coordinator, had a good plan, but just wore him down, Rodney.
Well, and give Andy Hall credit, as we talked about earlier, playing through pain, being the guy to manage the offense for them, being patient in the first half when he had to be, taking some shots in the second half, and then the big completion in the fourth quarter to keep a drive alive that got them going.
Can you imagine what's going through his mind now? He transferred here, and it looked like he wasn't going to play at Georgia Tech. Now he's going to the NCAA Division I AA Championship.
Once again, the final score, Delaware 24 and Wofford 9. For Rod Gilmore, Mike Godfrey, and Holly Rowe, Sean McDonough saying so long from Newark. Let's send you back to the studio, and here's Matt Weiner.